Good evening, everybody. I'm Gary Hall, the Dean of Washington National Cathedral, and I'm sorry I have not been able to be here before tonight, but I wanted, on behalf of Bishop Marianne Buddy, the Bishop of Washington, and all my colleagues here, and everyone in our volunteer life and our worshiping community, to welcome you all to this final session, and to express my gratitude to Grace and Patty and Ruth and everyone that's been involved in putting this together. Those are the folks in the cathedral congregation life and staff life, and I know there have been others that have really helped organize this as well. You know, one of the great blessings of my life in the last decade has really been my own increasing engagement with Islam. Before I came here to be dean, I served a parish in the Detroit metropolitan area, and I happened to be in in Bloomfield Hills when the Koran burning guy from Florida was coming to Dearborn, Michigan, and so a bunch of us clergy got together with the Islamic community and actually began to really talk to each other and get to know each other. And I actually began to study Islam at age 60, which was, I apologize for, I have no excuse for not having studied it earlier, but my engagement with it since that time has been deepening, and it's really been one of the great blessings of my recent life is to really encounter Islam and its depth and beauty as a tradition and as a faith community. So I'm really grateful for that experience and also for Washington National Cathedral's continued involvement in interfaith work, and especially its increasing engagement with the Islamic community, both in the United States and abroad. You all know about our Christian-Muslim summit that has been going on now for several years, both here and abroad. And I think you also all know about our the Muslim prayer service we had in November and our continuing engagement with the Islamic community here in the DC metro area and in the nation. The great Houston Smith, who was a great scholar of world religions, once said that if a Martian looked down to Earth and looked at all the world religions and looked at Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, that Martian would see one religion with three branches. And as a Christian, I'm always mindful of the fact that that Jesus and Mary are both major figures in the Quran. And so I think as we, those of us who are Christians and those of us who are Muslims, come to know more about each other, the more we will know of the deep continuities between our traditions and the deep respect that our traditions have always had for each other, despite what some momentarily popular leaders might say, at least from my tradition. And so, again, I'm grateful for this. So I'm going to begin with a prayer and then turn the festivities over to Grace Saeed, who will introduce our speaker. Let us pray. God, we give you thanks for the many and ongoing ways in which you reveal yourself to the human community. We give you thanks for the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, and the God of Jesus, and the God of the prophet Muhammad. We ask that we be drawn more deeply, not only into the knowledge and love of you in these manifestations, but also that we may be drawn closer to each other as we endeavor both to stand in our own communities, but also to reach out and experience the depth of each other's traditions. Bless our time together, bless our ministry together, and grant that everything that we do may be for the building up of your reign and your purpose in your world. We ask all this in your holy name. Amen. All right, Grace.
As part of my introduction to the series, I'd like to tell you something about myself and recount two stories that are many years apart, yet very similar in their content. I belong to a rich and varied culture in which my Christian faith coexists happily with the largely Muslim culture in which I grew up. The motivation for this series is based primarily on the plurality of cultures that make up the identity of many like myself from the Arab Middle East region, Dr. Haddad included. The first story. In 1980, my brother, the literary critic Edward Said, tried to interest a New York publisher who was then looking for third world books to publish the work of Naguib Mahfouz, the great Egyptian novelist. And here I quote my brother. After a little reflection, the idea was turned down. When I inquired why, I was told with no detectable irony that Arabic was a controversial language. Mahfouz, of course, went on to win the Nobel Prize for Literature. The second story. A month ago, Amir Zahir of the Civil Arab blog wrote about an incident in upstate New York. Here I quote, Pine Bush High School decided to celebrate National Foreign Language Week by reciting the Pledge of Allegiance in a few different tongues. The plan was to have students narrate the pledge in Italian, Japanese, French, Spanish, and yes, Arabic. Well, an Arabic-speaking student took to the school's intercom and pledged allegiance to the flag in her heritage's language. And exactly what you might imagine might happen, happened. Some students started hissing and booing, and a number of parents called the school in protest. By the end of the day, the principal announced an apology over the school's intercom system. Much of the uproar revolved around that all-important passage of the pledge, one nation under God. When translated into Arabic, God, as all Americans know, with much thanks to Fox News, becomes Allah. Amir then goes on to explain the etymology of the word Allah, which is the Arabic word for God and is used by Jews, Christians, and Muslims alike. These stories illustrate ignorance and misinformation surrounding anything Arab and anything Muslim. It is sad to say, but the mainstream media, our forever growing roster of experts, pundits, and talk show hosts have made matters worse by sensationalizing news, relying on dubious claims by questionable authorities, and describing events without a context. Islamophobia is on the rise, and as Reverend John Peterson mentioned in a forum here a couple of weeks ago, it is based in large part on fear of the other. This series on Islam, presented by scholars and well-respected analysts, will hopefully provide you with credible information and offer answers to questions about Islam and what it offers to so many around the world. Tonight is the third and final session in our Islam series. The topic is political Islam. The format is the same as the previous sessions. Dr. Haddad will introduce Khaled Elgindy, today's speaker, who will then provide opening comments on today's topic. Dr. Haddad and Mr. Elgindy then start their conversation. Midway through the session, we will begin collecting your questions. So please raise your hands should you need index cards for questions. Tonight's session will end with suggestions for the future. What would you like to see going forward? Ruth Frey, the Cathedral's program director, will be listening. So please suggest ideas about lectures, programs, or whatever that you think the Cathedral should consider. We are all enormously grateful to Dr. Yvonne Haddad, who has so graciously offered her knowledge, expertise, and time in framing this series. Dr. Haddad is professor of history of the history of Islam and Christian-Muslim relations at Georgetown University. She has taught Islamic studies at many universities and conducted research on 20th century Islamic thought in Egypt, Jordan, Kuwait, Morocco, and Tunisia. Dr. Haddad has served as the past president of the Middle East Association and the American Academy of Religion, New England region. She is the recipient of a Fulbright Senior Research Fellowship, a Distinguished Research Fellow from the Helsinki Collegium for Advanced Studies, the National Endowment for the Humanities, and a Carnegie Research Fellowship. Of course, I could mention a lot more, but you get the picture. Dr. Haddad will serve as our moderator for this session. Thank you.
Give the 5-minute introduction. Yeah. Good evening. last week and the week before, we had a lot of questions about Sunni Shia, and I promised I would give you an instant pill that you will be the expert on Shias from now on. So a sheet has been passed, and it tells you the different Shiites. And basically, the word Shia means anyone who has moved away from the Sunni. Sunni means the straight path, the real truth, and the majority of Muslims are Sunni. So throughout history, anybody who didn't agree with this majority and had a different idea, they were called Shia. But basically today, there are the remnants of these Shias historically, and the sheet tells you the differences among them. Basic difference between Sunnis and Shias is their theology about the Quran. Is the Quran the word of God that pre-existed before creation, or did it come into existence when God spoke and uttered the Quran? So the Sunnis believe that it was eternal with God and changing. You don't need to interpret it. It is valid for all time and place. The Shia believe that it was revealed in time and place when God spoke at the time of creation, and therefore you always need somebody to interpret it. So they have mujtahids, and this is where Khomeini and Khamenei and all the other mujtahids come in, because they're the ones who interpret it for the general public. Whereas the Sunnis, they can interpret for themselves, even though we know that they have ulama who interpret for them. Now, the beginning of the fight between the Sunni and Shia is a political matter. When the Prophet died, the community met together and trying to think who is going to take over. And Omar, who later became the second caliph, reached out to Abu Bakr, who was the first one, and said, "I recognize you as our leader." And that's how the caliphate was started. And the Shiites believe that the caliphate should have gone to Ali, who was the son-in-law of the Prophet Muhammad. And so the division is from the beginning on who is going to be the legitimate leader of the Muslim community. So you will see that all the Shiites believe that Ali is the legitimate leader, and his position was usurped by the Sunni caliphate. So that is an old thing. Up until the end of the 19th, probably the middle of the 20th century, Sunni and Shia lived together, they intermarried, they weren't worried about this conflict that you see today, in which it is described that they're all killing each other and fighting each other, and they are in different places. But if you watch with me, you will see that we have at least three main branches of Shia, and the reason we divide them into three branches is that on the left-hand side, there are the Zaydis, and they're the ones who believe in the first five people who came down from Ali. So Ali is the first, Hassan his son, Hussein his son, Ali Zain al-Abidin, and Zayd. So anybody who stops with the five is a Zaydi. Today, these are the Houthis that are in control of most of Yemen. Okay? They're different than the Shiites in Iran, who are on the extreme right, what we call the Twelvers, because they believe in 12 imams. And you'll see they share with the Seveners 7 imams that they share, they recognize as legitimate. Now, let me look at the Seveners who are in the middle. You will see that the one that they recognize last is Muhammad Ismail. From that, we have a Fatimid dynasty, which had a caliphate in Egypt that lasted from 910 to 1171. And from these, we have the Druze. The Druze are a sect which exists in Israel, Lebanon, Jordan, and Syria. And some of them, most of them, don't consider themselves Muslims, and many Muslims don't consider themselves, consider them Muslims. But then from that, we have the Ismailis. The Ismailis believe that that there is an incarnation, that the head of the Ismaili community, the Aga Khan, is an incarnation of God. And there are two kinds of Ismailis, the Musta'alis and the Nizaris. The Nizaris are the larger group, and they follow the Aga Khan. And the Aga Khan has moved his operation into Europe. He has a palace in Geneva, and his major operation is out of London. And has a large community up in Canada. We have some here in the U.S. There are some in Syria that are being attacked right now by the ISIS. On the right-hand side, you have the Imamis, which is the majority of the Shiites, and they believe in 12 Imams. If you go all the way down, you see Muhammad al-Muntazar, who is the Mahdi. The Mahdi is the one expected to come at the end of time. He will come, and Jesus is going to come. So there are two theories about the end of time, whether Jesus is going to come first or the Mahdi will come first. But once the Mahdi comes, there will be peace on earth, because there will be a lot of turmoil before that. So there is this expectation, an eschaton at the end, and we have throughout history many claimants to the title of Mahdi, but most of them have died, have been killed, have been rejected as not authentic. Now, if you look, there's an offshoot after the ninth one, Hassan al-Askari on the right, that's the Alawis, and they are the Shiites of Syria. Okay, there are some Alawis in Lebanon, in Tripoli area, and some Alawis, a lot of Alawis actually, in Turkey, and some of them have moved to Germany, and they make a substantial group among German Muslims. If you have any other questions, you know, after the meeting, I'm willing to talk about them later. But what we're here for today is to listen to our guest speaker, Mr. Elgindy. Khaled Elgindy is a fellow in the Center for Middle East Policy at the Brookings Institute. He is the founding board member of the Egyptian American Rule of Law Association, established in the spring of 2011. Before arriving at Brookings, Elgindy spent more than 5 years as an advisor to the Palestinian leadership in Ramallah on permanent status negotiations with Israel, and was a key participant in the Annapolis negotiations held throughout 2008. Prior to that, he spent many years in various political and policy-related positions in Washington, D.C., both inside and outside the government. Elgindy is the author of numerous analyses and articles on the Middle East, peace process, Israeli-Palestinian affairs, Egyptian politics, and related subjects. His articles have appeared in Foreign Affairs, Foreign Policy, The National Interest, The Washington Quarterly, as well as other publications. So as usual, he will give a short presentation, and then I will ask him the questions that my students have prepared for you for tonight. Three of them are in the audience tonight, and then we will open it up to the rest of you. Please.
Thank you, Dr. Haddad, and thank you, Patty and Grace and Dean Hall for inviting me here tonight. You know, I was telling Grace as we were walking in, the last time I was in this building was on September 11th, 2001, during the memorial service that was held that evening here. And so I'm very happy to be here on a much less tragic and somber occasion, but it is, I think, quite relevant. That coincidence is quite relevant to this discussion, as I'm sure you can imagine. So I'm going to talk a little bit about Islam and politics, but before I do, I thought I would kind of race through some contextual issues before kind of tackling the meat of my presentation. Since the broader series is focused on Islam in America, I thought I would just sort of highlight some basic facts. Many of you probably already know, but for those of you who don't, there are about 3 to 7 million Muslims in America. About a quarter of them are African Americans. The rest are immigrants and the children of immigrants, primarily Arabs and South Asians from the Indian subcontinent, as well as Iranians, Turks, Southeast Asians, Africans, etc. And actually, the Muslim community in the United States is one of the most ethnically and racially diverse of any religious group, which really reflects, of course, the diversity of Muslims around the world. About 81%, actually I was quite surprised by some of these statistics, about 81% of Muslims in America are US citizens, myself included. 37% are US born. 63%, I thought this was very interesting, 63% of American Muslims say that they see no conflict between their Islamic faith, between being a devout Muslim and living in a modern society like the United States. Roughly the same proportion as Christians who say the same, about 64%. first and second generation Muslims like myself, I am the proud son of immigrants to this country like many people probably in this room. First and second generation Muslims are really quite similar to other immigrant communities. They came here for the same reasons, to the so-called American dream. And for the most part, they are highly integrated and socioeconomically speaking, rather successful, relatively successful. And this is important because it's different than Muslim communities in other Western societies. What we don't have in this country, and this is very relevant to our discussion, we don't have sort of ghettoized Muslim communities that you see in countries like France and even in the UK. And that has a lot to do with the kind of Muslim extremism that we often see, particularly in Europe. Muslims, by and large, have slightly higher household incomes. I'm talking here about immigrant communities, slightly higher household incomes and education levels than the national average. Again, this is not necessarily the case in other Western societies, as far as Muslim communities are concerned. I think it's also important to point out that Islam, as a presence in this country, has been around for as long as America has been around, and even before the Republic, in fact. A very large percentage of American, of the African slaves who were brought to this country were Muslims. Over time, they lost their Muslim faith. And then in the 20th century, we saw sort of a resurgence of Islam within African American communities. But we've also seen evidence of Muslims who fought in the Continental Army in the Revolutionary War. Several hundred Muslims fought in the Civil War, including at least two commissioned officers. So Islam is part and parcel of this society in every way. The second point I want to sort of draw out is a distinction between Islam as a religion and political Islam, or what is sometimes referred to as Islamism. Islamism is sort of an odd term because we don't talk, religion is itself an ism. So we don't talk about Christianism or Judaism-ism, but probably because it's verbally pretty awkward. But I think you get the idea. Political Islam, in some ways, is unique, but I think, by and large, is very similar to revivalist movements found in other faiths, including the Christian faith. Islam, of course, is a religion of 1.6 billion people. It's a global religion, a universal faith. It exists in every corner of the world and has for more than 14 centuries. Islamism, if we use that term, is a political philosophy, or really more accurately, a set of ideologies or philosophies that emerged in the last 100 years or so. And that draws on, clearly, Islamic moral and legal teachings and seeks to organize society on that basis, or on those bases. It's, I think, important to point out that extremists on both sides, both Muslims and non-Muslims, have an interest and routinely blur the lines between Islam and Islamism. We often hear it sort of in tropes like, there's no such thing as moderate Islam, or radical Islam is an oxymoron. These are the kinds of sentiments, really, that that I think where it's very important to combat, and discussions like this are crucial to that goal. A few quick points on Islam as a religion, then we'll cut to the chase. We'll go right into the political Islam discussion. As some of you know from the handouts here, which I found very very useful. Islam is firmly rooted, as we heard from Dean Hall, Islam is firmly rooted in the Abrahamic tradition, both in its adherence to monotheism and in its universal values. I think it's important to emphasize this. Islamic values are not different than so-called Judeo-Christian values, despite the obvious conflicts that have occurred in history and that continue in one form or another today. But as many of you know also, Old Testament prophets from Adam, Noah, Ezekiel, Abraham, Moses, David, Solomon, and others are mentioned and revered in the Quran, as well as the New Testament, including the virgin birth of Jesus, who is the son of Mary. And Mary herself is considered one of the four righteous women in Islam. In addition to figures like John the Baptist. From a theological, epistemological, and moral standpoint, I would say Islam has more in common with Judaism and Christianity, certainly, than what separates them. But even more, and maybe this is controversial, but I would also argue that Islam has more in common with Islam, with Judaism and Christianity, probably than they have with one another. Specifically, like Judaism, Islam embodies a law and focus with a great emphasis on obedience to God. Those of you familiar with the Jewish faith in the Jewish tradition, halakha is Jewish law, is quite similar actually in many ways to Sharia, Islamic law. And in fact, the two words halakha and Sharia roughly have the same meaning, which is a way or a path. On the other hand, like Christianity, Islam is also very much a spiritual path that emphasizes piety, good works, and so on. In its essence, stripped to its essence, Islam really is about protecting and preserving five basic rights: the right to life, the right to worship, the right to intellect, the right to lineage, and the right to private property. These are what Islamic scholars have essentially distilled. The Islamic concept of justice really comes down to these five principles, you might look at them really as sort of natural rights in the liberal sense. That's not to say they're always pursued, obviously, in a liberal sense, but the ethical and moral and philosophical underpinnings of Islam are I think quite familiar, if not similar, to those found in the Jewish and Christian and other faiths. And in fact, these five principles constitute the very purpose of Sharia, which is Islamic law. And there's probably no more abused term in the Islamic lexicon than Sharia. We hear a lot about it, certainly in the media, and about 99.9% of what we hear really is nonsense, has nothing to do with Islam, and can simply be discarded. So the purpose of Sharia is justice, and the goal of Sharia, the way that is pursued, is through these five principles that I pointed out. Contrary to what many people believe, Sharia law, as Muslims understand it, actually requires Muslims to obey the laws in the societies in which they live. So no one need fear that Sharia is here to supplant the American Constitution or subvert it or to somehow overthrow the Republic. All of this is nonsensical, fear-mongering, pure and simple. So jumping now into the subject of Islam and politics. Obviously, I made the distinction between Islam as a religion and Islamism, which is a set of movements, philosophies that are obviously related. Before getting into that, let me provide a little bit of regional context. Many of you are aware that there have been a series, well, you're certainly aware of, I'm sure, the great turmoil that is happening throughout the region, and really the enormous instability that we've seen over the last 4 or 5 years since the Arab uprisings began in North Africa, in Tunisia, in 2010. And then in Egypt, we saw another uprising. Some of you may remember the famous images from Tahrir Square when President Mubarak was overthrown. And we saw kind of a domino effect, at least in terms of uprisings, if not actual changes in regimes. We saw rebellions in Yemen, in Libya, in Syria, and in other places. Many of which, and specifically those three that I just named, Yemen, Libya, and Syria, have been quite tragic and quite violent and have not worked out as far as the initial ambitions of the young people who went out into the streets, nor, frankly, has the Egyptian experience been very promising either, but it's certainly been much less tragic and much less violent than what we've seen in Syria. But by and large, what this tells us, what these rebellions were really all about, was a generation that had grown up and sort of come of age and realized that their part of the world had been left behind, essentially. 50, 60, 70 years of dictatorship, of military rule, of bad governance, of corruption, of a lack of accountability, of police abuse, and every other form of bad governance that you can imagine, a lack of economic opportunity, a lack of space to pursue intellectual and entrepreneurial pursuits. This was a generation that rose up and said, we've had enough. The problem was, of course, that it's not enough to simply rise up. You actually have to have a political program and you have to have a political organization in place. And so while there were substantial numbers of these people out in the streets, they were able to effect some change, but they weren't able actually to assume power, which is not unusual for uprisings and revolutions. Those who start them are seldom the ones who finish them. But what happened is it created security vacuums and political vacuums that were filled by pre-existing and empowered and in some cases armed actors that were essentially able to take control. And what we've seen in these places like Syria is a real breakdown in the state and a breakdown in governance. And of course, a tremendous human tragedy in the process, where millions have been displaced internally and outside of their countries, as well as these sort of sectarian resurgence and sectarian animosities that have come to the fore and also fueled violence. That's by way of some, you know, some recent history. But the term political Islam, going back to the subject at hand, the term political Islam refers to a set of movements that emerged in the early 20th century in response to the collapse of the Ottoman Empire, what was really the last caliphate in history, and which also corresponded with the rise of European colonialism in the Middle East. And so you had this great upheaval in not just who governs, but how these societies were governed. This presented an obvious challenge to many constituencies throughout the region, and Islamism was an attempt to sort of reassert an authentic, not colonial, not imposed from the outside, an authentic Islamic doctrine of political of politics and governance. Many of these Islamist movements were central components in the nationalist struggles against the colonial powers and in the post-colonial state-building process that took place after independence. Many of these Islamist movements also, like the Muslim Brotherhood, for example, which is sort of the grandfather of most of the mainstream Islamists throughout the Arab world and beyond. Many of these organizations served as incubators for a range of political activism. Many secular movements and activists, for example, emerged out of the Muslim Brotherhood, and vice versa. We saw in later decades former communists and socialists become Islamists simply because it represented a more relevant or more appealing form of activism. And so ideology, much less religion, is not always a driving force in these movements. We saw a resurgence of these movements in the 1970s and since, you know, right up until today, as a result of this kind of failing governance, particularly in the military dictatorships, the republics of the Arab world. In essence, these Islamist movements are, I think, at their core, a response to the social, political, and economic dislocations and upheavals that have been caused by modernity or rapid development. And I think it's really quite similar to other religious revivalist movements in that sense. Islamists have certain things in common, obviously. There are certain things that make them Islamists. With each other, they have certain things in common with each other as well as with other revivalist movements. I would point to two principles. The first is the primacy of Islam, both as an overriding identity and as an organizing principle for society. The second is the marriage between Islam and politics, the belief that what is moral is inherently political as well as legal. Again, not unlike Jewish, Christian, and other so-called fundamentalist or revivalist movements. And with that, there comes some baggage. There comes some common features. I think like all religious revivalist movements, to one degree or another, there is an emphasis on exceptionalism, perhaps even chauvinism, elements of chauvinism in these ideologies. There's a reason why evangelical Christians or fundamentalist Jews or Islamists focus their religion, because they see it really as the most important way to structure society. And that very often marginalizes, obviously, those who are outside of that group. And we also see, I think, another common feature is a socially conservative and traditional outlook, specifically with regard to traditional gender roles and other social norms. Again, very much like other religious conservatives. That said, I think there is also an enormous degree of diversity among Islamists, to the point that in some cases they may not even fall into the same, may not even make sense to group them into the same category. And these differences are based on differing interpretations of Islamic law and different understandings of Islamic governance. But that spans the entire spectrum. How they understand Islamic law varies. Their views on the nation state, the modern nation state versus the caliphate, also vary. And there's quite a bit of tension also between, there is a quietist camp among the Islamists, those who are averse to change, who are very much status quo, who are averse to rebellion, who will often quote a hadith, a prophetic saying, that it is forbidden to rebel against the ruler, even if he is a bad one. And then there are those who have quite the opposite view, who are quite revolutionary, and we see some of those active today. So there's quite a bit of variation between and among Islamist groups. Some believe in electoral democracy, like the Muslim Brotherhood, and some of the Salafis being the sort of ultra-conservative, those who are really literalists when it comes to Islamic teachings. Others consider any man-made legislation to be a usurpation of God's authority and therefore completely forbidden. The ones who fall in this category are the Taliban, Al-Qaeda, and groups like ISIS. They see no need for politics, because certainly not elections, because that would be haram, that would be forbidden in Islam, because it assumes a role that is reserved only for God. The kind of Islamism that we see, and I think this is true of any political form of political opposition, the kind of Islamist activism or activity that we see in a given context really depends on the socioeconomic political conditions of the society in which it emerges. And in the context of the Middle East, the most important factors have been governance, i.e. bad governance, primarily, and foreign intervention. Both of these have been major fuelers, I suppose, of Islamist activity and particularly Islamist violence. The more repressive the state, for example, the more likely we are to see these groups take up arms against the state. Again, I think this applies to almost any political opposition group, not just Islamist ones. Another trend that we've seen is that the strictest and most severe applications of Islamic law, the beheadings, the chopping off of hands, and so on, are usually found where there has been a breakdown in basic law and order, where the state essentially has ceased to function. Examples would include Al-Shabaab in Somalia being almost synonymous with a failed state, the Taliban in Afghanistan, again, a country ravaged by multiple foreign occupations, as well as state failure, and of course, the most recent example being ISIS, which I'll talk about in a second. Failed states have also become havens for outside what I would call parasitic groups like Al-Qaeda and like ISIS that sort of thrive on the security vacuum and the absence of governance, both as platforms to govern, as territories to govern, but also as platforms to launch their attacks and as an operational base to launch their attacks. And we saw that with Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan in the lead up to 9/11. The bottom line is repression and dislocation produce alienation. And Islamist ideologies essentially give meaning to that sentiment and offer a way out, or at least presume to offer a way out. And I think therein lies the appeal. A final word, I'll end with the subject of ISIS, which I know is on a lot of people's minds. ISIS is unique in many ways. ISIS was formed in 2004, it's at least a decade old, as a branch of Al-Qaeda shortly after the American invasion. There was no Al-Qaeda presence in Iraq before the American invasion, and now, or really anywhere in the Levant, in the Fertile Crescent, that part of the Middle East, but certainly we see that there is now. That group morphed into what was called the Islamic State in Iraq, and they became the real center of gravity for the insurgency fighting the American presence in Iraq. And again, the group morphed again into the Islamic State in Iraq and the Levant after the crisis in Syria, and there was a vacuum created with huge ungoverned spaces in Syria that they were able to take over and exploit, and they became ISIS, the Islamic State in Iraq and Levant, or instead of Levant, some people say Syria. And then last year, the latest iteration of ISIS is as the Islamic State. They are now the epicenter, the Islamic State, the caliphate. And that is designed primarily to appeal to young people from around the region and around the world who, you know, the notion of the caliphate is quite romantic, particularly in an environment where governance has failed and where foreign intervention, both by regional powers and by outside powers, is common. And so the idea of a caliphate, you can call it a marketing ploy, you can call it something much more serious, but it's clearly quite appealing to a large number of people. So what you have essentially is a perfect storm. I mean, ISIS really represents this perfect storm of foreign intervention, failed governance, and the dashed hopes of Arab youth. And I think therein lies its appeal. But ISIS is unique also, I think, because it is uniquely brutal and violent in ways that that even folks in Al-Qaeda find distasteful. And I think that really says something. I mean, the people who launched an attack on the United States and killed 3,000 innocent civilians even, I think, are horrified by the kinds of gratuitous and almost nihilistic violence and brutality that that ISIS represents. They almost seem to revel in that brutality and gruesome atrocities that they carry out. But they're also unique in a different way. The ISIS, unlike most Islamist groups, really has an apocalyptic ideology. I mean, they are sort of doing all of these things to bring about, to help accelerate the end of times. That is, you know, there is a messianic concept in Islamic theology. It's there, but it's not very prominent. And certainly not in the more traditional Sunni doctrinaire legalistic Islamic traditions that we see most of these groups falling in. And so it is kind of, in some ways, a hybrid. I mean, it's ideologically and theologically new territory as far as Islamism is concerned. And I know I've gone on too long, so with that I will end my remarks. Thank you.
Right now I will ask him questions, but you can write yours and somebody will collect them and bring them up front. I noticed that while you were talking, you gave the five rights and people didn't write them down fast enough. I noticed people couldn't follow you. So could you repeat them, please?
Yes. The five basic principles of Islamic justice are the protection of life, or the right to life. Just so I don't miss any. The right to life, the right to worship, the right to intellect, meaning free thinking, the right to make choices for yourself as opposed to slavery. The right to lineage, again, I think a concept that is similar to slavery, in that you have the right to your own history and heritage. You have a right to know who your ancestors are. Unlike, for example, slaves who were brought to this country who were given new identities and their own histories and heritages were erased. And the last one being the right to private property, which is quite fundamental in Islam. And so really, Islamic law exists to preserve these basic, you might call it sort of the, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness kinds of bare bones of Islamic philosophy and jurisprudence.
One of the things you said is that what you hear about Sharia is nonsense. And I was just wondering to what were you referring?
Everything.
Everything
that we hear in mainstream media or popular culture, the vast majority of it is nonsense, both in how it understands what Sharia is and what it presumes Sharia to be doing, the threat that it allegedly poses. And so the definition of Sharia is deeply flawed, as well as it's almost like a straw man. They've they've reinvented Sharia to be this thing that poses this threat. And now you see I don't know how many states have passed.
22
states. That means rational, educated, in most cases, legislators have enacted these laws. In some cases, they were put to a referendum. Presumably an informed citizenry have voted on these completely, this imaginary threat. It's frightening how pervasive it is. And how mainstream it's become.
But there are people calling for it, even mainline Muslims overseas.
Calling for Sharia.
For Sharia.
Right.
So how do you define what is authentic Sharia and what isn't?
Well, that's the interesting thing, is one of the phenomenon, if you look at when these Islamist parties have come to power, this has been one of the key questions that they've had to face early on. And a test both for their kind of base of support and for their opponents. How are you champion Sharia. Sharia is a slogan not just for American politicians. It is first and foremost a symbol and a slogan for Muslim politicians. Sharia is something that all Muslims revere. It's not something that they're afraid of. It's not something that they despise. It's not something that they loathe. I mean, it's something that is important. And Sharia governs everything from marriage to inheritance to, to charitable giving. Sharia encompasses, but people have different understandings of what Sharia is. For some people, Sharia is what I do between me and my Creator. And if I abide by, God's commandments, then that's my Sharia. For others, it's much more legalistic and the responsibility of government to try and enforce. That's been very tricky for Islamists because they have to strike this balance. They make the populist appeals to Islam, which of course everybody, sure, Islam's great, will vote for you because you represent Islam. But then they come to power and there's this expectation that they either are going to implement Sharia or they're going to do something with it. But nobody really knows exactly what to do with it, how to implement it, what does it mean to implement it, how much of it are you implementing. It's not as if Sharia is the Ten Commandments. It's not just clearly delineated set of laws, X, Y, Z. It is a corpus of opinion. It's more like case law than it is like actual legislation. And so you've got this great big body of legal opinions. Some of it conflicts with each other. And how do you implement that? It's much easier to do. It's much easier to, you know, push that button in an election campaign than it is to actually do it. So the further right you go on the spectrum of Islamists, you know, in terms of literalism, like the Salafists, for example, they have a very literal understanding of the Sharia. The Sharia is, and they can probably enumerate for you, a set number of legal requirements. The Muslim Brotherhood, which tends to be a big umbrella of Islamists that spans the gamut from Islamist Democrats to much more conservative Salafi types, they have to fudge the issue to appeal to their base, to maintain their base, as well as to appeal to non-Islamists. Because at the end of the day, if you won't get elected purely by your base, which is, you know, let's say in the Egyptian context, never more than, you know, 15% or so of the population. So you have to appeal, obviously, beyond your base of support, you know, your diehard Islamist base. And in order to do that, you have to fudge the issue. And so they were never very clear, and that was one of the issues when the Brotherhood was in power briefly in Egypt, is they did fudge the issue. They didn't actually enact Islamic laws. They didn't ban alcohol. They didn't impose the veil by law on women, although I've heard Fox News reports inaccurately say that they did. You know, but they did make appeals to the same sort of populists. You know, they were like politicians. They go for the lowest common denominator. You go for the kind of, you know, the low-hanging fruit, and imposing the veil or banning alcohol is not the low-hanging fruit. It is deeply divisive, and they just they weren't ready to tackle that. We see the same thing with Hamas in Gaza, where it also didn't really Islamize Gaza. Of course, Gaza is quite conservative to begin with, but it didn't go out of its way to impose, you know, sort of Islamic guidelines. To some extent it did, but usually when it was kind of politically up against the wall, not because it felt that it was good politics. It did that out of insecurity because it needed to play to its base rather than face the public. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's a very long answer to your question, but
you know, if we bring it to the situation in the United States, you know, we have Shariaphobia all over the place. But you have some Muslims, especially the ones who are involved in the mosque movement, you know, those who go to the mosque who are sort of conservative Muslims. They would like certain parts of the Sharia to be operative. You know, for example, there are studies that show that some women in Michigan, when they divorce, they are not willing to get 50%. They want to get what was written in the contract. Or if the father dies, they want to take, you know, they want to inherit only half because they are devout and want to follow the restrictions of the Sharia. And it's, when people ask that the Sharia be implemented in the United States, everybody begins, oh, they're going to take over and make America a Muslim country.
Yeah.
How do you deal with that?
Well, I mean, look, the Muslims are a diverse group.
Sure.
In this country and around the world. And so there are conservative Muslims who have very rigid traditional interpretations of their faith. And they ought to be able to, you know, one of the great things about this country is that you have religious freedom to practice or not practice however you like. And so if someone wants, I mean, I'll give an example. If these Sharia bans go into effect, what that means is that someone like me couldn't get married according to my faith. Mm-hmm. You know, I could only do a civil marriage. I could only go down to the justice of the peace, and you know, we fill out paperwork, and then we're married. But in the eyes of my own faith tradition, I would not be allowed to do that. I would not be allowed to make a will so that my children inherit according to my understanding of my faith. Whether or not somebody likes those proportions or percentages, that's what it would mean. I'm fairly confident that they wouldn't hold up, in a Supreme Court challenge. I mean, they are fundamentally unconstitutional. but that is essentially what they're aimed at. You know, there are Jewish groups in this country who live in communities governed by Jewish law, mm-hmm. and it's expected that everyone in that community respects Jewish law. So after sunset on Friday night, nobody's turning on and off the lights. You don't drive down the street in these neighborhoods, whether or not you're Jewish. And that's in the United States. So that is not a subversive attempt by Jews to take over, or subvert the American Constitution. That is maybe an extreme example of a group that chooses to live by its own faith traditions, irrespective of what other people think. And there are Muslims, I think, who feel the same way. Mm-hmm. And they should be entitled, you know, the woman who wants to inherit less, if that's her personal desire, she ought to have the freedom to inherit less than. But at the same time, you know, in Islamic law, there is a provision for something like a will, you know, so that you could, these proportions that are delineated where a female inherits half the amount as a male these are archaic. I mean, but they're specific to a particular time. If I were writing a will, I might compensate for that and say, well, you know, that's the minimal provision that is provided in the Sharia. But there's nothing to prevent me from compensating with it with a document like a will, where I could more evenly distribute those resources. It's a question of personal or religious liberty on the one hand, choice, I suppose, on the other. Mm-hmm.
When the Muslim community started emigrating after 1965 to the United States, you begin in, actually starting with 62, you have the formation of the Muslim Student Association, which is part Jamaat-e-Islami of South Asia, and Muslim Brotherhood of Egypt. And they had some guests from overseas who would come. And you know, one of them was Muhammad Ghazali of Egypt. And he came and said in the 70s, I bring you greetings from the land of peace, Darul Islam, Darul Sun, to you who dwell in Darul Harb. Who dwell in the domain of war. Right. So the United States was a place where you don't stay. And you had people like Maududi of the subcontinent and the teachings of Sayyid Qutb, who said that Muslims cannot live under non-Muslim rule. And you get somebody like when Sharisi's fatwa in during the Spain, when the Reconquista took place. And the Muslims were given a choice, convert, leave, or die. So they wrote to Ansharisi, was in North Africa, and said, "What do we do? They've lived 800 years in Spain, and now they had to either convert to Christianity, be killed, or leave." And he said, "Come, Muslims should never live under non-Muslim rule." Yeah. At the same time, there were other fatwas that said they should. So what should the American public who look at this, see one fatwa and then another fatwa, and then they are suspicious, which one is operating? Because the Muslim Student Association changed its motto. This America is Darud Dawah, is the place of mission. That means they want to convert people. Mm-hmm. And there is this panic, They want to turn America into Islam, and that's what the Shariaphobia comes from. It's being played up by an industry, I know that. I want you to explain this to the public who don't know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, I mean, the Muslim Student Association has itself evolved over the last half century. And groups that have sort of branched out from the Muslim Student Association. I think, that is sort of part and parcel of the Islamophobic discourse. All of which, I think any stereotype or trope or negative impression is sort of rooted in a kernel of truth. I mean, it's never a complete fabrication. No one would say, the Quran comes from Mars and Islam, Muslims are actually aliens who, I mean, maybe someone says that, but it has to be plausible somehow. And to be plausible, it has to be rooted in something, some historical moment that's true, regardless of how representative or unrepresentative or relevant or irrelevant that fact is. The fact is that the MSAs, Muslim Student Associations, and other Islamist organizations in the United States no longer believe that. Mm-hmm. I would say that the vast majority of Islamic scholars would not agree with that ruling. There are always moments in history and spaces on earth that you will find someone who says something that, and you say, "Aha! This guy issued a fatwa saying kill anyone who insults the Prophet." Okay, there is that person, but is that the consensus of the scholars? And Muslims put a lot of emphasis on the consensus of scholars because there is inherent in Islam, because it is legalistic, because it is, by definition, argumentative, there's a debate, there is an emphasis that's put on consensus. And in fact, there is a prophetic saying that, a saying attributed to the Prophet Muhammad, that differences in opinion between scholars is a mercy, which is, in other words, don't become so overly, don't lose the forest for the trees. If religious scholars disagree over something, well then consider that a mercy to you. That is a way, that's your way out. That suggests that the issue probably is not going to be the determinant of whether you get in or out of paradise. The idea of consensus is very important. So the question would be, how representative is that fatwa or that opinion, and how relevant is it? What action is actually associated with it? What implications does it have? And I think In the example that you gave, it's not very relevant, and it's been superseded by other opinions.
One of the questions my students prepared for you said that Keith Ellison was the first Muslim elected to the American Congress. And of course, now we have a second person. And there were some people in the Muslim community who thought that it's not right that Muslims should participate. The other hand, everybody seems to welcome him and look up to him as somebody who broke the barriers. What do you think, the Muslim reaction generally is in the United States towards participating in American government. I mean, you have people, for example, demonizing some of the young people who are working in the hallways of the government. Right. There might be about 10 of them, and they think, they're taking over the United States government, right? So what do you think the general atmosphere in the Muslim community?
Anecdotally, I don't have scientific evidence, but you know, my impression is that the overwhelming majority of American Muslims and Muslims in America are in favor of, are quite proud of people like Keith Ellison, who's not only the first Muslim in Congress, but he's also quite outspoken, not on so-called Muslim issues, but on a whole range of issues. And I think he's a role model in that sense. And so, yeah, he is a model. He shattered sort of a glass ceiling for Muslims the same way that, you know, Hillary did for women or others, you know, Eleanor Roosevelt. He is someone who, or Jesse Jackson when he ran for president. That was an important moment, not because people thought he would win, but because it was the idea that you could associate a black man with the White House was important for people to overcome. And lo and behold, today we have, you know, an African-American president. And so I think the sentiment in the Muslim community is overwhelmingly supportive of participation in the American political process. And the problem is that American Muslim participation in politics is seen ipso facto as evidence of attempts to subvert or take over or dominate or whatever, destroy America. And so we saw these events in Texas and Oklahoma where they had these Muslim Capitol days where they would go and meet their members of Congress, their state legislators, and they did something similar, I think, in Congress. This is every politician's fantasies to have an engaged, engaged constituencies, but when it comes to Muslims, it was seen as a threat, and so it's a threat if we're not involved in politics and we're seen as sort of above politics and we're waiting for the moment when we can wage a jihad and take over the White House, and it's also seen as subversive if we engage in politics in the same way that every other American does. It's unfortunate that for a lot of people in this country, Muslims are still the last group that it's okay to essentially strip them of their Americanness, whether literally or figuratively, we don't want to think of them as American, even when they actively want to participate. And I would just point out that many of the groups that support these activities are in fact Islamist groups with ideological and philosophical leanings, you know, toward the Muslim Brotherhood and, you know, kind of like the Muslim Student Association. And they actively support electoral politics. In fact, they love electoral politics because they're really good at organizing, that's what politics is about.
What are the political issues that the American Muslims care about at the moment?
Islamophobia is one. I think civil liberties, civil rights in general. The Muslim-specific issues would be those. I mean, obviously, Muslims also care about the economy and education and, you know, the whole gamut of issues that the rest of the public care about. But specifically, I would say Muslims are more disproportionately concerned with issues like civil liberties, particularly since the Patriot Act and like-minded legislation. But also a range of foreign policy issues. And some might argue that Muslims maybe are overly focused on foreign policy as opposed to domestic policy. The issue of Palestinian rights has been, you know, is probably the one issue on which there is, you know, overarching consensus among American Muslims and Muslims around the world, frankly, which is not something that you can say about a lot of other issues.
So what are they going to do in the next presidential election?
Yeah. Well, you know, Muslims, by and large, are not one-issue voters. If they were, they would not vote for any member of Congress, I think. If Palestinian rights were the basis by which Muslims voted, they couldn't vote for, you know, 99% of Congress members. So it's not. It's just one of these things that I think most American Muslims are sort of realistic about. And they hold their nose and vote for, you know, whoever is the least worst.
You know, talked about ISIS at the end of your presentation, and you know, we were discussing it in class today. And a question, you know, is why does it appeal to European young people, to European women, and also, what of its propaganda makes it attractive?
You know, that's a good question, and I think there will be many a dissertation written on that subject in the years to come. And so I can't claim to, you know, I certainly haven't done any you know, research on the subject. But again, anecdotally and kind of impressionistically, I would say, you know, the idea of the Islamic State, of the Caliphate, I think is very romantic. And for a lot of young people, they simply don't believe the stories that they see in the media. They've been raised, or they believe that the media hates Muslims, right? The Western media, and so they are there to propagate lies. And so, you know, they don't believe a lot of the stories of brutality that are in the mainstream press. That's one. You know, the naivete maybe of youth and romanticism, but also disaffection. I mean, there is a sense, you know, I sort of alluded to this in the presentation. You know, European Muslims are not all alienated and disenfranchised, but a good portion of them are, and it's a real problem. It's a real problem that the French and the British and the Germans and others, the Dutch, have had to contend with this notion of multiculturalism and how they approach it. And the fact that they actually approach it through the lens of multiculturalism as opposed to citizenship is problematic. And so you've got these ghettoized communities, particularly, I think, one country that stands out is France, where, you know, Muslim minorities are not well integrated. You know, particularly Muslim minorities from countries that France colonized, and so there is an inherited sense of superiority, and then there's this threat of, you know, boy, it was one thing when we were over there, but now they're over here, and it's, you know, there is the traditional xenophobia and fear of immigrants who are taking our jobs and, you know, raping our women and, you know, all the sort of fears of that, you know, swarthy men will do, and that plays out, you know, and
and so you've got this dynamic where these communities really are marginalized to a large extent. And so you combine that with this, you know, overly romanticized view, disaffection with their, you know, they've given up on politics. What's the point in participating in local politics? They're all out to get us, or they hate us, or they've marginalized us. And so it becomes very appealing. And it's partly based, I think, on mythology, you know, and manipulation. I think the people who recruit on behalf of groups like ISIS are really masters of social media. And I think like so many people of that generation, they really just, in ways that I can't even wrap my brain around, they've just mastered I see kids who are like, you know, on Twitter who are 19, 20 and they have 80,000 followers on Twitter, and they're not like prominent famous people, but somehow this is they're able to do that, and so they know how to use these tools, and they're also masters of manipulation, I think.
So now we come to the questions from the audience. Sure. These are not manufactured by my students, okay. But they're a response to what you said. Okay. To what extent has U.S. policy towards the Middle East contributed to the rise of ISIS?
To what extent has the
U.S. policy towards the Middle East?
I think it's a good question. And again, it's something I alluded to. I think it has to a great extent contributed to the rise of ISIS in a very direct way. Because, as I said, there was no Al-Qaeda branch in Iraq before the American invasion, and then you had the Al-Qaeda in Iraq that morphed into the group that became ISIS, and that was able to take advantage, of course, of the vacuum that existed right next door in Syria. So, it's a very complicated relationship. I mean, I certainly wouldn't say that the United States planted or created ISIS, although there is that conspiracy theory. There are people in the Arab world and the broader Muslim world who genuinely believe that ISIS is they're so cartoonishly evil, they can't possibly be real. They are a construct of the CIA and Hollywood and have been, it's either theater, fiction, and so they're not really doing what they're doing, or what it appears to be, they appear to be doing, or that they were funded and created and sort of let loose in order to destroy, to eat away at the heart of the Muslim world. And there are people who believe that, educated people, people who are quote-unquote westernized. It's in the same way that you have people who believe in a completely imaginary threat of Sharia in this country, who are educated and modern, and, you know, who don't live under a rock. And so you've got this, you know, we live in an age of identity politics and fear of the other, and conspiracy theories are very common in that sort of environment.
The next question is, what in your view would bring the end of ISIS and other such revivalist movements?
The person who answers that question will earn a Nobel Peace Prize, because, I think what we can do is look at the causes of ISIS. I think part of the problem with the administration's approach, which is to put together this coalition of regional powers to combat the threat of ISIS, is that it overlooks the environment in which ISIS was created, part of it being the American intervention. You know, the United States went to Iraq, destroyed the country, and eliminated its leadership. And it's no surprise then that former Ba'athists and lieutenants of Saddam Hussein are turning up as ISIS generals in this war. The very same people that the United States drove out are now, in a way, exacting their revenge. And I think, irrespective of their own religious or ideological views, these are people who are bent on revenge. And the human capacity to rationalize is almost limitless. Maybe they've convinced themselves that they're genuinely doing, you know, God's work on earth. But at the end of the day, they're out of a job and out of power and are really angry about it. So, we have to address the fact that we left Iraq broken, and left it to fester, but also not just to fester, but to infect its neighbors. And so now that infection has spread to Syria, and you've got this thing called ISIS. And part of that also, Syria, has to do with the fact that we don't really have a coherent policy on Syria. It was, you know, remember the red lines that kept getting crossed, and you know, the Assad regime had to go, and then, well, maybe not so much. Maybe they can stay
for a while.
For a while. Especially when you see the alternative is ISIS, you start thinking, whoa, Assad looks pretty good. Well, you know, the reality is Assad has killed far more Syrian civilians than ISIS, or civilians in general. And so American involvement, dictatorship, the lack of accountability for both of those are fundamental sources of this thing called ISIS. It didn't occur, you know, out of nothing. And so intuitively, I would say you have to address the kind of root causes and the sources of the problem. But it's not politically expedient, you know, to blame yourself, to, you know, to take responsibility, or your friends in the region, all these Arab dictators that the United States has funded and coddled for decades, the Saudis, right? I mean, there's an ideological component, you know, the ideological distance between ISIS and the rulers of Saudi Arabia is not that huge. It's just, you know, these guys are a little bit cleaner. They don't wear black masks when they do their beheadings. And they don't randomly, you know, to be fair.
They wear masks when they do the beheadings.
They certainly don't make a show of it. Yeah, they don't make it into a big theatrical production. But to be fair, though, the Saudis don't go out, pick 10 Christians and chop off their heads. I mean, you know, the Saudis are repressive, certainly, and, you know, across the board, particularly against the Shia minority, particularly against women, but generally, it's obviously not a democratically ruled society, but they're not ISIS in some very important ways, and so I don't want to make you know, I don't want to be flip about sort of equating them, but ideologically there are clearly similarities, and so you know we have coddled the Saudis, we've coddled the Egyptian military regime for years, and we were quite uncomfortable when it looked like the Egyptian military wasn't going to be in power. And we sort of, like, I think, breathed a sigh of relief in a way. We were disappointed. I think we're ambivalent, really, about Arabs and democracy, partly because maybe we the United States thinks that they're not ready for it, but also because we don't know what it's going to produce. You know, will they maintain the treaty with Israel? Will they still allow our tourists to come? Will they still allow our companies to come and invest? You know, those sorts of things. We don't know a lot about Arab societies, and so we're naturally afraid of what genuine Arab public opinion might produce. So I think, you know, I think there has to be a lot of soul searching, but I think the United States has an extra responsibility. And that's not to absolve anyone in the region. These movements are indigenous. Groups like ISIS are self-inflicted, you know. But the United States has done a lot, has contributed a lot to that process, and I think we need to own up to it, and we need to tell our friends in the region that, you know, repression and oppression are not the way, whether they're the Israelis, the Saudis, the Egyptians, or anyone else, frankly. And we shouldn't get, anyway, I mean, I think, you know, I think it starts with some self-awareness. Mm-hmm.
This questioner says, the key to current Islamist movements is the Sunni-Shia rift and attacks on each other and the splitting of societies, which many believe the West and Israel have exacerbated with funding and policies on purpose. Please comment. ISIS, Hezbollah, Hamas, Al-Qaeda.
Could you read the first part, the key to?
The current Islamist movement is the Sunni-Shia rift.
I'm not sure I understand what the key to current movements is. If the questioner is saying that what motivates current Islamic movements more than anything else is Sunni-Shia split, I don't believe that's the case. Sunni-Shia animosities and suspicions are, almost 14 centuries old. And they're real, but they're also, I think, to a large extent, artificial, if that makes sense. They're ginned up in this case. I think the Sunni-Shia issue is very sexy for some reason in the media and even in the Arab media, because it plays into the geopolitics, which is there are states like the Gulf states headed by Saudi Arabia and the UAE, the United Arab Emirates and others, against Iran and Iran's regional ambitions. And so Iran, of course, is a Shia majority and the Gulf states are Sunni majority, although with substantial Shia minorities. And so it plays into that. And so if you want to make Iran the bad guy, we start seeing Iranian hands in everything. And Iran is involved and does interfere. Obviously, it did in Iraq, and it does with its support of the Assad regime, and it did with Hezbollah in Lebanon. And of course, there's even involvement in Yemen. But I think it's overly simplistic and politically expedient to see it in Sunni-Shia terms. By way of example, it wasn't even a decade ago that Hassan Nasrallah, the head of the leader of Hezbollah, the Shia militia of Lebanon, was the most admired man in the entire Arab world. I mean, hands down, he won every poll. He was Times Man of the Year in the Arab world in 2006. Why? People didn't think he was Shia. People didn't think about him as being Shia. Now people look at him and say, oh, he's a tool of the Assad regime and part of the problem in Syria. And so his ratings have gone down clearly. There were times when Ayatollah Khomeini, after the Iranian Revolution, was hugely popular in the Arab world with Sunni Islamist movements like the Muslim Brotherhood. And so the same Muslim Brotherhood that today and when the Brotherhood was in power in Egypt were playing on Sunni Shia sectarian sentiment and playing up fears of Iranians and Shia because it was the populist thing to do. In the same way that Protestants and Catholics maybe in other contexts might do. But it's a very, I think it's a pretty superficial sentiment. Mm-hmm. It doesn't run that deep. And I think when this conflict is over, it won't be remembered as one between Sunnis and Shia, but really, it's multiple conflicts sort of overlaid on top of each other, a generational conflict, a geopolitical conflict with Iran and the old order in places like Egypt and Syria trying to entrench themselves or retrench themselves and stay in power. There's multiple conflicts. So, I think the sectarian thing is somewhat artificial.
This is several parts to this question. It says, since mainstream Islam denies the validity of separation of church and state, how can non-Muslim rights be secure? And in particular, how the rights of women.
Yeah, if you can tell me what mainstream Islam means, then I'll be able to answer your question. Because it's, it's very hard to say Islam does or doesn't, certain things, obviously you can't argue that Islam embraces the idea of polytheism, for example. That's clearly beyond the pale. Or that Islam welcomes alcohol as a social vice. But it's not necessarily true that Islam, as even mainstream Islam, is incompatible with the notion of citizenship. There's a lot of Islamic apologetic writings to that effect, that the first constitution that enshrined citizen rights was the Pact of Medina, written by the Prophet, in which he, safeguarded the rights of non-Muslims and women's rights. Women are completely equal. Some of that is sort of apologia and not really true, but there's an element of truth in it, in the sense that there is a, Islam is big on the concept of law, and the preservation of order and people's rights through law, and citizenship is rooted in the same concept, that your rights as a citizen don't derive from the color of your skin or what sex you are or how tall you are, but through your agreeing to this social compact. You're part of this social contract. And so the Pact of Medina was a social compact in that sense, hundreds of years before, Rousseau and Locke and all the rest of them. And so it's not a liberal document, but it certainly lends itself to that. And so the point I'm trying to make is that Islam doesn't preclude the notion of modern citizenship rights. And it doesn't necessarily, the notion of church and state. Muslims have been struggling with this concept. When Islamists argue that Islam is inherently political, okay, fine. You might argue inherently legal, but political is kind of a hard sell, because the one thing Muslims never got right was the politics. Muslims did a lot of great things throughout history, but the politics they didn't really do well at. And the Sunni-Shia divide, as you pointed out, was largely political, in the sense of, the very first challenge politically that you face in any polity is who succeeds the leader when they're gone. And that's where they failed. So the consensus broke down immediately. There were those who said, has to be the most qualified person and the eldest and the one closest to the Prophet, and that's this person. No, it has to be from the bloodline of the Prophet, has to be this person, and they've never agreed. And ever since then, various versions of that failure have sort of been playing themselves out over and over, where we don't see the blossoming of democratic governments in the Arab world. Even at a very promising moment a few years ago, when we saw these uprisings and we thought, maybe this is that moment. It's not because of Islam that you have these dictatorships, but Islam also, I think, is not... in other words, I'll put it this way. The Islamist slogan, the slogan of the Muslim Brotherhood, is Islam is the solution, right? And the Islamophobe slogan is Islam is the problem, right? I would say Islam is neither the solution nor the problem, but because Islam doesn't say how to govern. That's the fundamental problem with the Islamist model, is that, and why you have so many, this whole spectrum of models is because there isn't an Islamic way to govern. There was no church There was no pope who you could look to and say, this is the law and this is how you should. For there to be a Protestant movement to rebel against it later on. So we didn't have that institution to begin with. So, you know, I hope that's not too obscure that. Of a...
But I've got the real question for you now. What is the basis of the suicide bombing? Is that because they want to go to heaven?
Yeah.
It doesn't add that they were going to have the Houris there, 72
of them?
Yeah.
But subject to...
They didn't put that. I added.
look, I mean, Muslims didn't pioneer suicide bombings either. Frankly, there are very, sadly, few innovations coming from the Arab and Muslim world. And even suicide bombings we didn't invent. You know, it's a very old tactic of war. You know, that is ancient. And I think, you know, the point I made about rationalization and the human capacity to rationalize being almost limitless, you can find justification for anything. You pick a verse out of the Bible or the Quran or the Constitution randomly, and you can find a way to rationalize any action and its opposite using that same text, okay? I'm exaggerating slightly, but, you know, if you find a tactic that is somehow useful, it terrifies your enemy, you have the element of surprise. You, as the weaker party, you don't have the sophisticated weaponry that your enemy does, and so you have to rely on these kind of tactical advantages, like surprise, like you know, sort of dramatic but relatively small-scale kinds of attacks, high casualty sort of stuff. You know, if you find that to be useful, you will find a religious and/or moral and/or legal and/or philosophical justification for it. And suicide bombing is one of those. There are, you know, people who, in the name of freedom, after 9/11, the Patriot Act people, went about trying to curtail American rights in the name of freedom. So there's something obviously deeply ironic about, you know, in the name of freedom, I'm going to curtail your freedoms. Because anything can be rationalized with the right conditions. The conditions being fear. Oh, you know, you ask people before 9/11, would you accept the Patriot Act? What if I told you the majority of the stuff that was in the Patriot Act was stuff that the DOJ and other federal law enforcement agencies had sitting on a shelf for years? It was their legislative wish list, but they could never pass it through Congress. They knew they couldn't get through Congress. It took something like 9/11, when you had a fear that a public that was fearful, and politicians who were clearly receptive to that, to be able to get it through. So the point is, suicide bombings, at the end of the day, are not about the 72 whatever. Virgins is not the right translation. It's not, you know, it helps, of course, if the person who is going to commit the act is motivated, right? What is going to motivate someone to go and end their life, especially if they're young? Well, one, if my life already kind of sucks, you know, things are really bad already. Two, I'm promised instant paradise. So these kinds of rationalizations are important, I think, to get the people to do that. Otherwise, who would kill themselves? Especially a young person who has, you know, their whole life ahead of them. So, you know, again, I'm not evading the question, but I genuinely believe that almost anything can be rationalized using almost any principle or text.
I agree. I went to seminary where we used to do exegesis and eisegesis, in which we explained the Bible, And when somebody asks me this question, I always tell them that the Bible sanctions suicide bombing because of the story of Samson. Do you remember Samson? He's a great guy, you know, he's a hero. What did he do? He killed everybody, right? And killed himself. So it's a divinely sanctioned mode of resistance to oppression. Right?
Because
now he agrees with me.
No, I agree with you. I mean, it's to martyr yourself, right? The concept of martyr exists in every culture and in every religion for the greater cause. The cause being God or the nation or the people, whatever it is. You know, there are monuments to martyrs all over the world. Mm-hmm. And martyrs are people who willingly go into die or prepare to die for this greater cause. And so it is, it's not something unique to Islam.
So this question is asking about which of the three traditions, this is the last question, okay? Which of the three traditions is the local mosque on Mass Avenue? Is it Salafi? I mean, I don't know what.
It is Sunni, as far as I know, but it's not, as far as I know, I don't think it belongs to any particular school of thought or sect. Or I mean, it's. I think it was mainly set up for the diplomatic community. So it's not. It's not entirely non-denominational, but it's not.
Thank you
sectarian.
Very much.
Sure.
I really appreciate it. Great job.